Hi, just going to talk you through a little project I've made with a pie grow for monitoring soil moisture. You see, I've got a Raspberry Pi in a nice waterproof box here. This is just a simple sandwich box. What I've done is I've put the holes in and epoxied the cables in place. Keep it nice and waterproof. We open this up. You see, it's just the Raspberry Pi Zero in there. Their power cord, obviously, and the wire to the four chirp sensors. Plugged in nice and simply. So, should be able to mount that without any trouble. Plenty of room in that box if you want to add other things as well. So, it's a very handy little solution there if you want a nice waterproof pie grow. And these are the chirp sensors. I've used four of them. They're connected to the I2C bus, which means you can connect a large amount of items just to the two I2C pins there. And these are actually very nice little probe sensors. It's got a mark on it to tell you how far to stick it into the ground. About that deep. These are actually ruggedized ones that have got this waterproof plastic over them, and they've been coated in some form of epoxy or I think that looks like epoxy, to be honest. Just a waterproof membrane around it there, and this is a capacitance sensor, so doesn't need to be in contact with the soil, unlike some of the cheaper sensors, which wear away very quickly. This has got a very long life. It will, in theory, last as long as it needs to. Won't corrode at all. These can obviously be buried all the way if you're so inclined, when they're fully waterproof. Nice and simple use of the sensor. It's got a thermometer in here, so it will offset that and attempt to correct any temperature changes to the soil moisture, because obviously the temperature affects the conductance. So interesting sensor. They do have a light sensor on as well, but this is covered up by the plastic if you're getting a ruggedized one. So if you want to use that, then get one that isn't ruggedized and protect it yourself. And you can epoxy them and stick this on them, just leaving a gap for the light sensor or whatever you choose. A simple little system. But as you can see, I've actually got 20 feet of cable for each of the sensors. The I2C bus is actually only designed for very short distances, but the chirp here works fine. I've got them connected to the 3.3 pin on here, but actually what I've done is a bit more interesting. Let me have a look. The chirp does have a minor issue sometimes where it can readdress itself, because you can readdress the chirp sensors to various numbers on the I2C bus, meaning you can connect lots and lots of sensors to the same bus. But sometimes that can cause a problem, because if there's power fluctuations, which I've been having a lot of trouble with recently, power cuts, it can actually cause fluctuations that mimic the signal that readdresses it. So often these will end up getting readdressed. It can happen. So what I've done is I've written a little script, which is quite useful. What it does is when you turn on the Raspberry Pi, it's a cron job on boot. I've got it turns off three of the pins, and it turns on one of them, checks that, and it says this is blue on pin GPIO pin 20. So that should be on the I2C bus, say 20. And it has a look, and if it's not on ITC bus 20, and it looks for it, it changes it onto the 20 position. If it can't find it, then it tries a couple of positions that don't actually show up on the Raspberry Pi GPIO bus. So it's, you know, very reliant. I've tested this a couple of times. It works very well from what I can see. It does, of course, mean that you end up using more GPIO pins than maybe you'd want to. It's not necessary. If you are short for space, you can, you know, risk it and hope it doesn't happen. But I just find this is nice. It's very reliable, very secure little system. And as I had plenty of spare GPIO pins, as you often will, and this will hopefully not cause any problems. Obviously, you've just got to plug in the USB power, and then I've got the four chirp sensors all graphing to different logs. You can log those, you can make graphs out of those together or individually. You can control them together or individually in groups. So, handy little device. This is actually made for someone. They're going to be testing and measuring the soil moisture in a retaining wall, I believe. So that'll be really interesting to see how that goes for them, see what sort of results they get in the more long term. So yeah, that's the soil moisture sensor, the chirp. I'll show you a couple of tricks on how to use that now. First thing we want to look at is the GPIO's ITC. And it's got to be turned on, so you've got to do that in the Raspberry Pi settings. Hopefully make a button for that here soon, so don't worry about that too much. Here it's found the ITC bus. Baud rate is 30,000, which is actually, I've changed that from the default using this button here, because that's what they suggest for the chirp. And this button here, the ITC check, you just bring up a list of all the devices it's found on the ITC bus. Here it's found four for me, because I've already got all my sensors set up. And we can look in the sensors tab. We can set all that information here. The name, the location that you want to save a log to, the wiring info. This one's on the ITC. You can actually get chirps on use other connection protocols, but so far I've only added the ITC ones, because I've only had an ITC one to play with. It's connected on OX51. It's minimum and maximum values there, which are used for working out the percentage. You just press the calibrate button to set them. It will say, are you sure you want to do this? It takes a bit of time. Then it will tell you to fill up a glass with water. So you just put it up about to the line on the chirp sensor, as how I've been doing it, and that seems to work. And then that will run, and that will find the maximum value of this, because it's in water, it's obviously 100% moist. And then when that's done, it will give us a value, you know, maybe 760. Say, do you want to use this? We say yes. And then it will just ask us to take out the soil moisture sensor again and leave it in free air. And then that will just log that one for the same amount of time, finding the lowest value this time. And you've got the lowest and the highest value. You can then use those to determine the percentage, which is a lot more accurate than just the raw soil moisture read. The extra info here, GPIO 20, that's if you're going to be using the automatic setup script, that you want that running on startup. So what it will do is it will just work through each of the sensors, check they're in the right place, and it's repeating every 1 minute. That's just for testing. I'm actually going to change it when I'm using it. Probably maybe every quarter of an hour, half hour maybe. Maybe even every hour or less. A lot of the soil moisture sensors you really don't want to use very often. You don't want to poll very often because it will make them corrode quicker. You don't have that problem with the chirp, so you can actually log the chirp every 1 minute if you want, every like, you know, a few seconds even if you really want to. No, it's probably too much data to be useful there. But the 1 minute is pretty interesting when you're configuring it, setting it up. You can see how it responds to water, particularly if you're bottom feeding your plants and put the water in the bottom. You can see how it's like the moisture content's creeping up and where it gets to. So that's a very useful feature there. Hooks is quite simple. I just run in Chrome log chirp script with a flag name equals chirp, whatever it is, like whatever I've decided to name it. A soil moisture sensor to graph it. We just go into the Pygro graphing thing, chirp, and we've got all the options. Because I was obviously using the logs from setting my own log paths, because I've used 4 different chirps and logging them all to my own unique thing, I'm going to have to name. And I've already that automatically, and that will just magically tell the Pi to make the graph. Obviously, because it's making it on the Pi, it's using the most instant data, so it will use the whole thing. Tells a bit of information here is how many information points we've got, what the most recent soil moisture level was, and when we got it. So that's they're all very recent, or within about 15 seconds. Here we can see the graph. This graph's quite interesting actually, because they were like, before they were calibrated, in the calibration process, you can see obviously that's why I'm putting them in the water, so I'm taking them out again, and they're set now when I like, choose that calibration value. It'll go nicely on the zero mark. You can see that red one, that was the one I put in the water in the house. So very simple to see what's happening there, the percentage of the moisture. Normally of course between 0 and 100, so that one's about up near 100 somewhere. So takes a bit of getting used to, like the soil moisture values, what they relate to in terms of your water, but they are very consistent. So once you've got it working, you've got it set up, you can get a good look at what your plants are doing, how quickly they're taking on water, how, you know, which shows you obviously their transpiration rate, which is very useful to know how well your plants are doing, what sort of rate you should be feeding them, and just their general health. Hopefully soon we'll have this and some other options to trigger a automatic watering system. That will be coming soon, but not quite yet. Thanks very much for your interest.